World History presents Fall of the Third Reich, narrated by Sam Devereaux. Introduction. Hitler preferred death to flight. Adolf Hitler ruled Germany for 12 years. As the Third Reich began to collapse in on itself in the spring of 1945, the Führer took up residence in Berlin. By the middle of April, he'd entrenched himself in a bunker deep beneath the capital, as the Soviets bombed the capital around the clock. Eventually, even Hitler would have to face the fact that the war was lost. The Führer turned down all opportunities to flee, preferring instead to make use of both a gun and a cyanide pill at his doctor's suggestion, the surest way to kill himself. Hitler was only one among countless casualties in the war's final months. One of the war's worst air attacks cost thousands of civilian lives in Dresden, while in the Baltic Sea, a German refugee ship was destined to become history's biggest maritime disaster. Chapter 1. The Red Army Strikes a Decisive Blow. In January 1945, over 2 million Russian soldiers head west from positions on the Vistula River and the East Prussian border. Stalin's taken the decisive step into the Third Reich and now targets the country's capital. En route, Russian soldiers will take a terrible vengeance on the German population. The sun had not yet risen, but in the darkness, the soldiers in Marshal Ivan Konev's 1st Ukrainian Front could see their breath forming small clouds in the bitter cold. Comrades pulled up their collars to protect their necks and chins from the driving snow as they towed guns into position. There were bridgeheads all along the front at Baranov, 230 kilometers south of Warsaw, and the snow had been compressed by heavy artillery to create a slippery surface that caused problems for the soldiers in their clumsy army boots. It had been a long wait on the west side of the Vistula River, but now, in the early morning of 12th of January, the Red Army was ready to attack German positions. The Russian artillery was packed tightly along the front, with up to 300 guns per kilometer. At 4:35, the guns rained shells down on the German forces that were entrenched in three defensive lines, one behind the other. After half an hour's bombardment, the Soviet battalions stormed the German trenches, shooting anyone who survived the inferno. Specialist units scouted behind enemy lines to try and identify surviving strongholds. Their observations were sent directly back to Konev's artillery units, which targeted a new volley of shells directly at those positions. German officers were left in despair. "I began the operation with an understrength battalion," German battalion commander Reinhard Müller said later. "After the smoke of the Soviet preparation cleared, I had only a platoon of combat-effective soldiers left." As day dawned in his bunker on the Baranov front, Müller was aware that he and his countrymen on the Polish defense line would find it increasingly difficult to keep the Red Army at bay. The Russians had begun their onslaught against the German motherland, and the countdown to the Third Reich's collapse had begun. Stalin headed to the Oder River. The Russians had captured the bridgehead at Baranov back in the late summer of 1944, towards the end of Operation Bagration. The Red Army had expelled the Germans from Belarus and eastern Poland, and Russian soldiers had crossed the Vistula, Poland's largest river, at several points, seizing important bridgeheads south of Warsaw. Since Bagration, the front had remained relatively quiet, but German generals were in no doubt that it would not be long before the guns were rumbling again on the Eastern Front. Stalin, however, wanted to postpone the attack until the cold winter had frozen the ground like cement. This would allow Russian T-34 tanks to easily roll out to the Oder River and finally penetrate Germany. This meant that the so-called Vistula-Oder offensive could not kick off before January 1945. Until then, the The Red Army would move their forces and equipment to the three bridgeheads on the Vistula's west bank, from where the attack would begin. The deployment followed the maskirovka, masking strategy to mislead the enemy. Tanks and mobile artillery crept up to the front under the cover of night, with thousands of trucks full of ammunition and supplies. At the same time, the Russians tried to fool the Germans into focusing on an area north of Warsaw through fake radio messages and by establishing a ghost army consisting of 1,000 imitation tanks and other vehicles. The Nazis' intelligence service, the Abwehr, was in no doubt that the Red Army would soon launch an offensive on the Eastern Front, and that the obvious point of attack would be the bridgeheads on the west bank of the Vistula. It was the job of General Oberst, Colonel General Heinz Guderian, Chief of Staff of the Army, to present the critical situation to Hitler at the Führer's headquarters on Christmas Eve 1944. Guderian and his men believed that the enemy had 11 times more infantry, 7 times as many tanks, and an air force 20 times greater than the Wehrmacht could mobilize.
"It's the greatest imposture since Genghis Khan,"
Hitler shouted before dismissing the report completely.
"Who's responsible for producing all this rubbish?"
No significant redeployment of troops occurred. Hitler wasn't persuaded in the new year either when General Josef Harper, commander of Army Group A on the Wisla Front, asked for permission to pull his advance positions back to safer lines. The Führer refused to accept the Russians' superiority and remain unmoved even when, on 9th of January, Guderian delivered one final bleak assessment when he met up with Hitler again. "The Eastern Front is like a pack of cards," Guderian argued. "If the front is broken through at one point, all the rest will collapse." Konev broke through Baranov. Just 3 days later, on 12th of January, the load-bearing card came crashing down when Marshal Konev broke through the bridgehead at Baranov and crushed the Germans' triple line of defense. The headquarters of the German 4th Panzer Army was destroyed by noon, and when the Russian infantry stormed the trenches and rubble, the surviving Germans fled in panic from their positions. Meanwhile, Konev's 4th Tank Army crashed through the area's snowy forests, and by the afternoon, the Wehrmacht was forced back almost 20 kilometers. The situation was aggravated further by Josef Harper's forces along the Vistula's defense line, when the Red Army opened up a new front on the bridgeheads of Pulavi and Magnuszek, just south of Warsaw. With the same efficiency as Konev's troops delivered, Georgi Zhukov's 1st Belarusian Front bombarded its way through the enemy's defense on 14th of January, and 3 days later, T-34 tanks rolled into Warsaw unopposed. The Germans evacuated the Polish capital, which was unrecognizable after years of occupation and massacre. Only 162,000 of Warsaw's original 1.3 million inhabitants remained. Russians only thought of revenge. As the Vistula-Oder offensive swept across Poland, Soviet forces also penetrated north into East Prussia, where about 3.5 million Germans lived. It was vital to secure the Vistula-Oder offensive's northern flank to prevent a German attack on Zhukov and Konev's oncoming troops from the north. At the same time, a Russian campaign in East Prussia and Pomerania closed Hitler's supply ports in the Baltic Sea. For German civilians, the sound of Russian guns was a signal to flee quickly. Propaganda Minister Goebbels had warned his countrymen that enemy soldiers were barbarian hordes, only interested in destruction and revenge. Therefore, hundreds of thousands of Prussians packed their most important belongings in small carts and walked towards the Oder and Berlin. Elderly people, women and children dragged themselves through the freezing snow in temperatures of minus 30 degrees. The propaganda machine in Moscow did everything possible to provoke the Red Army into living up to its fearsome reputation. It promoted vengeance on the back of the German army's atrocities during the invasion of the Soviet Union. Millions of Russian soldiers and civilians were killed by Hitler's troops, who had also decimated Russian cities by destroying millions of buildings, including 84,000 schools and 40,000 hospitals. Russian propaganda always referred to Berlin as the lair of the fascist beast. And when soldiers crossed the border into Germany, they were greeted by posters reading, "Soldier, you are now on German soil. The hour of revenge has struck." Hatred of the Germans escalated. "A couple of times when entering houses, we found old people in them who had been murdered by our troops. Once I found a woman lying on a bed with a bayonet in her chest. What had happened to her? We left without asking," said Soviet scout Mikhail Bateman. He also admitted that our unit made no distinction between enemy soldiers and civilians. "The war turned us into beasts. The Germans showed us how to behave like animals. And for 3 years, they had schooled us well. Now we were following suit. I was a Jew, and I learnt all about their barbaric cruelty. I felt not a shred of pity, only hatred, a desire to kill every last one of them." Zhukov creates a wide front on the Oder. Within a week, Zhukov's troops had liberated Lodz, while Konev captured Krakow to the south. 2 weeks later, both of the giant armies reached the German border, which twisted and turned around 70 kilometers east of the Oder. War correspondent Vasily Grossman was hot on the heels of Zhukov's first Belarusian front when the troops invaded the city of Schwerin and Davata. Here, soldiers tore the clothes from the town's women in front of their families. "Women's screams are heard from open windows," recounted Grossman, who also saw a nursing mother dragged back into a barn where Russian soldiers raped her. "Her relatives came to the barn and asked her attackers to let her have a break because the hungry baby was crying the whole time," wrote the correspondent. German soldiers left to defend their fellow countrymen were scared witless. They knew they were targets for the larger Soviet army, and there were reports of German soldiers wearing women's clothes or Russian uniforms to avoid capture or death. Hitler found their poor attempts to defend the country disgraceful, and, in an attempt to halt the Russian advance, he replaced Josef Harper as Army Group A commander with Ferdinand Schirner. Schirner was chosen because he had always shown support for Hitler, but on the battlefield, he could do little with his demoralized units. Captured treasury was completely looted. The Red Army rolled on through the winter landscape at high speed, and on 27th of January, Marshal Zhukov could taste victory with such certainty that he informed the Soviet High Command that the Germans no longer had a single line of defense. Army Group A was split, and 4 days later, on the 12th anniversary of Hitler's coming to power, soldiers from one of Zhukov's armies navigated across the ice that covered the River Oder. The creaking ice was only just thick enough to support the soldiers, and under cover of darkness, they sneaked across the river and captured the town of Kienitz. From their new position on the Oder, the Russians could almost glimpse the German capital, Berlin, which was now 70 kilometers to the west. In the days before 2nd of February, Zhukov established positions along the middle of the Oder. Zhukov wanted to launch an assault on Berlin immediately, but Stalin gave the order to halt the march to the west. The rapid 3-week advance from the Vistula to the Oder had led to supply issues. The Polish and German rail network tracks were narrower than the Soviet ones, and military engineers began to expand the tracks to allow supply trains through. And trucks rolled through the captured territory with equipment to strengthen the front. Traffic also flowed in the opposite direction. Convoys of trucks loaded with war booty returned eastward to the Soviet Union. Russian soldiers didn't hold back when they looted Polish and German homes, taking anything of value. "The Germans started this war, so it is only right that we should now take their possessions," a Russian lieutenant noted in his diary. Clocks, porcelain and fur were particularly sought after, but clothes, Boxes of nails, tools, and window glass were all sent to the impoverished Soviet Union, too. In March, Konev's troops managed to capture something else of great importance, the Upper Silesian industrial region. During the winter offensive, Stalin had specifically pointed to the spot on the map while he looked at Konev and said one word, gold. The Russian occupation of the industrial area meant that Nazi Germany was cut off from vital raw materials that could keep its ailing war machine going. A German counterattack in Silesia was easily repulsed, and even the loyal Schorner had difficulty hiding his pessimism. "I must report that the military incapacity of the German units exceeds my worst fears. Almost without exception, they're exhausted. Their value is shockingly low. My impression is that the Russians can do what they want, without much effort," stated Schorner's message to the Führer on 20th of March. With the German army falling apart and the Russians standing at the Oder near Berlin, most Germans knew that the country was defeated. Hitler refused to surrender, despite the fact that the critical situation struck deeply into his previously indomitable faith in Germany's racial superiority. It was in one of the Führer's letters to Armaments Minister Albert Speer where it became clear. When Speer pointed out that Hitler would be eliminating all further possibility for the German people to survive, Hitler replied, "This nation will have proved itself the weaker, and the future will belong exclusively to the stronger Eastern nation. Those who remain alive after the battles are over are in any case only inferior persons, since the best have fallen." Hitler did not care about his country's fate, and had no desire to spare Germans who hadn't lived up to his ideals. From their posts on the Oder, the Russians prepared a decisive campaign into the lair of the fascist beast in Berlin. And the German people wouldn't be spared this time either. Chapter 2. History's Single Greatest Maritime Disaster. In January 1945, the former luxury liner Wilhelm Gustloff set sail from Gotenhafen. Over 10,000 refugees on board breathe a sigh of relief as the ship weighs anchor. The trip is only a stone's throw away from the dreaded Russian soldiers' positions. Yet ahead of them lies an even worse fate. The Red Army had been running roughshod over the Germans. From the east, soldiers swarmed forward, driving an ever-growing stream of refugees ahead of them. Most were women and children heading towards cities still under German control. They were desperate to find their way west to avoid falling into the hands of the brutal Soviet soldiers, hell-bent on revenge. 29th of January, the port of Gotenhafen. The Wilhelm Gustloff had been used as troop accommodation, but the refugee crisis saw her outfitted to ferry evacuees. Dieter Rauch was the accommodation officer on the Wilhelm Gustloff, but he was also a man with a problem. In recent days, lines of refugees had swarmed into Gotenhafen, now Gdynia in Poland, hoping to get a place on the luxury ship. The plan was that the ship would carry 5,000 people, but Rauch had lost track of how many people had pushed and shoved their way on board over the gangway. Rauch was out of notebooks, and while he and his team had previously noted every passenger, the situation was now out of control. The quayside was full of desperate people, and the rules for registering had long since been disregarded. Only Germans with travel documents issued by the Nazi Party were genuinely entitled to travel, but no one had the heart to turn away the throngs of women, children, and old people who had been walking for weeks before reaching the port. Second engineer Erich Göring could not believe his eyes when he made his rounds of the ship, as all the corridors that should be kept clear for escape routes were instead packed with refugees. To get through, he had to step over both people and their luggage. Two-person cabins were turned into dorms for up to 10, and in the dining room he could no longer see the floor for the mattresses that covered it. Even the large, empty swimming pool was filled with passengers. Hundreds of women's Navy auxiliary personnel had been accommodated in the mosaic-adorned pool, too, but one auxiliary, Ingeborg Dorn, flatly refused to sleep there. Instead, she found a little nook in one of the large salons. The thought of staying deep in the belly of the ship made her claustrophobic. 30th of January, 12:30, aboard the Wilhelm Gustloff. The engines were started for the first time in 4 years, and the Wilhelm Gustloff set course westward. The faces of those left behind were a picture of despair. In the final minutes before departure, even more refugees tried to board the ship, but they were pushed back. As the crew raised the gangway, several children fell between the ship and quayside, where they disappeared beneath the icy water. Just seconds later, as the ship started to maneuver out to sea, desperate mothers on the quay threw their babies and toddlers into the arms of unknown countrymen on the Wilhelm Gustloff, which now carried more than 10,000 people. Several passengers braved the frozen conditions to witness the ship leaving dock as the snow...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.